when it is there in the constitution, it is like a game. The miasm tries always to get stronger and stronger. Because the miasm, as I told you, is a negative force. It is not an organism, but it is a negative force. So, when you don't know how to make a balance on the positive side through your thinking and behavior and all this, so negative force gets stronger. So that is how the miasm gets more and more intensified, and the more you try to just suppress it without elimination. Suppress it means suppressing the manifestations, because the miasm will never keep silent or keep without manifestation. The miasm constantly makes its manifestations. So these manifestations are, first they are manifested on the inner planes, on the higher planes, like mind and will and understanding, all this. So as distortions, so the manifestations on the higher plane in the form of distortions in the activity of mind, that means the thought forms. So when the mind is influenced by the miasm, by the effect of the miasm, then the mind constantly produces disharmonious thoughts, because the thoughts, each thought makes its own form, that they are called the thought forms. So the thought forms can be harmonious or disharmonious. So when a thought is formed in the harmonious manner, then the mind of the person where the thought is formed is not subjected to any disturbance. When the thought that is formed is harmonious thought, then the mind is in a tranquil state. So the person in whose mind the thought is formed will experience a bliss. And also, because the thought is formed in the individual mind, and the thought which is formed in the individual mind is transmitted, because the individual mind is the part of the space mind. Because every individual has the individual mind, because there is mind in the space. Just like space, the mind is also there in space. So therefore, whatever thought is formed in our mind, it just does not simply kept only in the mind of the individual. So whatever thought is formed, then it is transmitted. It is transmitted. When once it is transmitted, then it can be received by another individual mind, because it spreads. Because thought has no limitation, it spreads into the space. Just like how you make a transmission of a program in the radio, broadcasted in the radio or the television, so it is transmitted. Wherever there is a receptive instrument tuned to this, so that receives this program. So there are many such instruments which are tuned. to this frequency, the frequency, the miasmatic frequency, because already there is miasm, and if there is miasm, then it is, it goes to this frequency, so it receives. So therefore, if you make harmonious thought, this harmonious thought will be broadcasted. If you produce disharmonious thought, so this makes its effect. So this mind, so the miasm always conditions the mind. The mind which is conditioned the miasm makes disharmon, produces disharmonious thoughts. By producing a disharmonious thought in the mind of an individual, the individual is affected, because the primary effect is on the individual. Suppose I entertain a disharmonious, a wrong thought about you, it is transmitted and then received, that is secondary. But first of all, in my mind, I have this evil thought about you. It may be hatred or anger or any other things which are not natural. So then, because it is produced in my mind, so it increases the effect of the miasm. So the miasm gets more strengthened by all these things. And so this affects the vital plane of the person, the vital body, gradually, because this does not always keep you only there. It starts affecting the higher plane and the lower planes, both sides. So therefore, the vital force, the vital plane is affected. The vital body, the functioning of the vital body is hindered. That is what we have seen. So automatically the vital body starts its reaction, because here there is no, in this stage, it is not due to external influence, but it is from internal. That is, it is the internal influence which is causing a obstacle in the functioning of the vital force. So this is internal influence. So to make this, to work out for about this influence, the vital force makes its secondary action, because here the primary action was produced by the internal influence itself. The factor which disturbed the vital force is internal. So this has produced a primary action from the internal effect. So the secondary action is produced by the vital force towards this. And then in this phenomena, the vital force produces its symptoms to express, and simultaneously makes an effort to bring this out, this effect, to clear this away. That is the natural way of action. And so to this we have to always remember. So whatever is not in accordance to the natural arrangement in us, because nature has arranged, it has a formula, it has a framework. But something goes against this natural arrangement, then this effect is, as quickly as possible, the vital force makes an effort to eliminate this and bring a rearrangement, a proper arrangement once again. Because if constantly this is kept disturbed, then it is dangerous for our existence. Because the alignment of all our planes, the physical, the vital, the mental, the higher, and all this alignment is disturbed. When this alignment is disturbed, then our life, our experience in daily life is disturbed. So it is like a chain action. So therefore, the vital force always makes an effort to normalize this. So in this effort, it produces a secondary action to eliminate this out. So that is the process, that is the healing process.
And is that by works? Can that be eliminated by works? Or is there meditation necessary for
it? Meditation will help this. Meditation
but if
and the presence of the in the presence of a person who is not in individual or personal level, as explained in spiritual astrology, a person who is completely elevated in the consciousness is elevated into the highest levels.
But suppose on a normal level, if you then say you have an ugly sari, for instance, would it be eliminating your hatred against me, or is it
no? It is not elimination of hatred, because When I utter some word to you, if this word is according to the harmonious thought, then it will have a harmonious effect on the other person.
Yeah, but in the case that the vital force is reacting negatively and wants to kick out this thought.
No, that is not in word.
By word?
No. That elimination, what vital force makes a course of elimination is not in the word. It is in the functioning, in the functioning of vital force, and then it produces a toxic effect on the vital plane, which is transferred to the physical plane. That is the process of elimination, not by word. You should, if your vital force is in proper condition, when you have not made any efforts to suppress this, then it should in a very short time this will be brought to the surface.
Okay.
That is the process.
So it will automatically
throw out because
but on the skin forcibly.
Yes, ultimately that is what happens. Ultimately that is the effect.
Mm-hmm.
But first of all, it is a work, it is an activity on the vital level. So this toxic effect means, on a vital level, toxic effect means an effort to normalize, and in this effort there is, just like how when a machine is working, there is a byproduct, like smoke and something else which will be thrown out. So on the vital level also, this is a work on the vital level. So in this work, while doing like a machine to work, then there is a formation of byproduct, a toxic effect on that level, and then that is not allowed to stay longer on the vital plane. So it brings this back, transforming this into physical form. So when once it is transferred to physical plane, then once again this is not to be allowed to stay in the vital organs, in the internal organs, because that will, if it will hinder the work of heart or lungs or kidneys and all this vital, so then there is a danger. So therefore, as quickly as possible, the same effort of vital force transforms this from this out, coming to the outermost surface. That is the natural way of activity. So that is what very, very clearly is explained. We have to understand when we study the explanation of Hahnemann about the chronic diseases, this is very, very clearly this is understood.
When you say outermost layer,
that's the skin.
Other expressions of elimination, like headache.
That is only symptom.
It produces
headache or it produces any pain. These are symptoms. But here, coming a substance coming out on the skin in the form of eruption.
So you can literally be allergic to somebody.
Yes, when it will open up. It will open as an eruption or eczema, whatever you call, scabies or eczema or any sort of furuncles in any form, because this has to be thrown out. Headache is only one symptom, but when you get headache, it is not completely thrown out. Headache is the effect of the chronic, of the toxic condition. That is an expression. Headache is an expression of the vital force. Symptom is an expression. That is an expression. Yes. But the effect, it makes two simultaneously the vital for activity of vital force, it makes two types of effects. One is it expresses what is happening in the form of symptoms, so that from this we will be knowing what is happening as an indication. And the another is to throw this what is hindering inside, because this toxic effect is brought into physical existence. So in the physical level, this should not be accumulated, just like how the garbage in our house. So in our house, what we do from time to time, we clean the house and eliminate the and bring the garbage together at one place and bring it out. We will not leave the garbage inside. So this is also a work. And in this process, when we are cleaning the house, for example, when we are cleaning the house to bring the garbage out, then that is the physical strain is there, of course. Sometimes we may feel, oh, this is a lot of work. So it may be. So in the same manner, here also there is a constant work for the vital force. So this formation of toxin is only the effect. That is where we have to properly understand why there is the toxic formation at all on the physical plane in any part of the body is only the effect but not the cause. It is not a disease. Formation of toxic substance is not a disease, but it is the effect of the disease. Or the disturbance is higher, effect is there on the lower plane. And when once a toxic substance is formed in the body, and then here there is another point. If this is not allowed to be eliminated as usual, when we do something to suppress or stop this, then what happens is, then there is constantly this toxic substance is getting accumulated. Then nature has placed another measure for this. That this is very subtle point. Then somehow this toxic substance is to be reduced. How it is possible? Because we are not allowing it to be thrown out. So then nature has created some microorganisms which can be fed on this, which can take this as food. The substance which is toxic for us is food for them. This is very difficult to understand in the beginning. It is logical, but very easy to understand, but not easy to accept, because we have studied in another way. That is why.
But then you have to know if which organ corresponds to which thought, right? For instance, if you have a kidney problem, you have to know that it corresponds to.
Yes, yes, that is what is. Yes, that exactly. And this is also very much because this exactly to that is what you see from medical astrology. In the medical astrology, actually, and also, for example, there is a book written by Max Heindel. He is H E I. It is on the other side. Heindel. Yes. He was a great scientist. He is a Rosicrucian and great scientist. Rosicrucian group.
And the title?
message of the stars. Yes, there he mentions so many dimensions in astrology. Astrological book, but not in this calendar, but he shows how from this who can know from the effect of the planets, how, what type of thoughts, how you are, and from this thought, how it is transferred to the distortion of the organs, all these connections, he explains this.
There is explanation, right? Not just the astrology.
No. Yes, it's more or less mostly medical astrology. It's given a wonderful explanation that actually that is what is given, that he has given this exactly what was given in the Vedic astrology. Because the all of them, most of them, they knew Sanskrit and then they have studied all this. So this is a great scientist, Message of the Stars, and there is also another book that is Hindel. Dumko pustakam ente Hindel de Message of the Stars nu unko pustakam ente
ha ade heading ade
ade unko de
astro
diagnosis, yes, andra book. Astro.
Sleeping but giving the right answer.
In the introductory chapters of Message of the Stars, he gave so many astrological
keys. Astro diagnosis. Astro diagnosis.
This is the same author?
Yes, same author. Astro diagnosis. In this.
The endocrine system, there is one small book maybe.
About the endocrine system also he has, in this also he has explained about endocrinal system and from the hormonal system, endocrine system and all this he has explained. These are the books where he has given in English. In Sanskrit there are original, but English. Because Varaha Mihira,
Hindel, who was the author of these two books? I
was a
Rasakrishna. He was a healer. He was a great healer. Both of these two, Hila, Hahnemann and Hindel, were in their previous births two disciples of Jesus Christ. Master E.K. said that Samuel Hahnemann and Max Hindel, in their previous births, they were direct disciples of Jesus, Master Jesus.
One of the
12 disciples.
Yes. Including
Judas.
Jesus had 12 disciples, so these are two, but not the Judah, but of course. He wants us to suggest some simple book in astrology.
Astrology and simple, they are not synonyms.
Practical
astrology, that is the name of the book. The author of this book was Seferian.
Second one came to India also.
And the first one is Alan Leo. Both were disciples of Madame Blavatsky.
And he was a Leo, right?
Yes.
He was not the Pisces.
they were very conversant with the Vedic astrology, all of them. So therefore here about this, the effect of the miasm is very subtle in our constitution. So the miasm, because it enters it the very subtler layers of the person, so it has occupied, when it occupies especially totally the mind, and when, because mind is screen, the reflecting surface, so when the screen is dirty, then reflection is distorted. That is logical. When the mirror, for example, when the mirror is there, if the mirror is distorted, then your face appears distorted. So in the same manner, this mind is reflecting surface. So all these thoughts, disharmonious thoughts, they keep disturbing. And the effect of this is constantly transferred. This is, so what Hahnemann explains is that when you close down, when you completely, repeatedly, when you try to close the outgoing of these toxic substances by suppression, it is not only suppression of symptoms, but suppression of the substance which is to be thrown out by destroying the outgrowths. So for example, there are pimples or something, outgrowths and all this, when you are cutting and destroying all this, that is one type. And another type is to use some medicines to stop whatever is coming on the skin in the form of the furuncles and all this, or some patches. For example, somebody may get patches like what you call psoriasis, for example. So all this, there are many, many types of expressions. So when you make any effort to close this, so by closing this, you are blocking this. So why, this is another dimension, what you find from Hahnemann's explanation, another dimension. So, which person is more influenced or affected by the microorganisms? Is the microorganism cause for disease? That is how now it is still the normal medical science. Microorganisms are attributed as cause of disease.
They were more intelligent in the Middle Ages because there they used microorganisms to heal the wounds.
Now here microorganism means bacteria. Bacteria.
But some
wounds are clean. Yeah. Yes. But he has explained very clearly that there is this toxic condition, this pathological condition first appears, and then the corresponding microorganism which can survive on this substance, that is attracted towards such person. So that is the actual phenomenon. Because this is not allowed to be cleared out naturally, so this is accumulating and accumulating. So when it accumulates more and more, it will block the complete operation of the organ, of the organs. So therefore, to save this person from such accumulation, when this is not allowed to be thrown out, the other alternative is that nature has arranged, because microorganisms are also produced by nature, not we have produced them. Like how we were produced, they were also produced. So every organism, every living substance that needs food to survive. So this toxic substance which is formed that is detrimental or dangerous for us, but for them it is food. So that is the arrangement in nature. Therefore, they feed on this organ, on this substance. So there are two methods to deal. You can use some medication to kill those organisms. That is what generally we do. We give some medication directly to attack and to kill these bacteria and microorganisms. Or when you deal properly with what is happening inside to eliminate the cause which is producing all this toxic effect. So when once you stop this cause, eliminate this cause, no more toxic effect is there on the vital plane, and subsequently no more toxic formation is there on the physical plane. And when there is no substance to feed, then they will disappear, they will vanish, microorganisms. So just like the same example which I have given in the beginning, when there is a blinking of the indicator, if you fill the fuel in the tank, then it will not blink anymore. Or if you break the indicator also, it stops blinking. So either you can break the indicator or you can fill the tank to stop this. So like this, you can directly destroy the microorganism, but that doesn't solve the problem. That may, for that time, it is temporary effect. If you just eliminate the microorganism, then for some time they will disappear. Same example, for example, a person is attacked by what is called malaria. So malaria is only a situation which we call a disease, but there is a sort of parasite. So it is identified, the Plasmodium parasite is identified as the cause of malaria. Hello? ఇప్పుడు పల్సిల్ అట్టు వన్ డేసేవా పల్సిల్ అట్టు వన్ డేసేసా 4 o'clock దాకా టైం ఉందిగా. నువ్వు నాకు 2 o'clock ఫోన్ చేయాలా ఉందో. ఈ పల్సిల్లా వేసాం కాబట్టి పెయిన్ స్టార్ట్ అవుతాయి ఇంకొంతసేపట్లో. పల్సిల్లా 1 a.m. కూడా దగ్గర పెట్టుకో. 2 o'clock మళ్ళీ చెప్పినాక ఓకే. సో దేర్ another lady is ready for delivery, and the doctors, they are measuring whether to make cesarean or, so I told her to give pulsatilla directly. Because the doctors fixed the time after 4 o'clock in the evening, so as already, and then therefore we have administered pulsatilla. So therefore this is what we have to, we can, when we understand, when we properly understand about this, so this miasmatic effect, so the effect of the miasm, that is very subtle in our constitution, so we have to identify it. So Hahnemann has explained us that even when the miasm is still not manifested, the effect on the physical tissues, even before that, when only miasm is, its effect is on the higher planes, on the mental plane and higher, and even yet it is not manifested on the physical plane, even then it can be identified. That is what Hahnemann has proved. It can be identified because of the symptoms that are exhibited on the, which we call the mental symptoms. Because we can, when we observe the behavior, the logic, the thinking and the behavior of the person, so then we can find an abnormality in the behavior of the person. So for example, you see what is called kleptomania. So that is a thieving instinct. So when a person is having this type of distortion, his behavior is abnormal, because, for example, I am here, so you have put a good instrument here. So then I think, oh, this is a very wonderful instrument. And then when you are busy in something, and then gradually I take this without your knowledge and then put it, and then afterwards, yes. So this instinct of stealing, so taking away, so this starts when the child has inherited certain miasm, then it starts even from childhood. So the child from the very beginning starts with this type of behavior. So when he is little bit grown, then he starts stealing money from the wallet of his father and mother, and then it extends, so he may, if he goes into the house of any friends with the parents, there also he does the same thing. So it goes on increasing. So this is one example. There are many, so much of examples. So such type of abnormal behavior. So for the person who is having this behavior, for that person it is not abnormal. It does not appear to be abnormal. But for others it is clearly observed as abnormal behavior. So this is how the effect of the miasm is reflected in the behavior of the person. So if this child, for example, who is growing boy or girl, or growing in age, so this tendency increases, unless you make some effort how to neutralize it, it increases. So if you do not consider this as an indication of internal disturbance, so if you keep quiet, then it will be after 15 years, when the 15 or 20 years, when the person reaches the middle age, and that time this will be manifested into a disease, a disturbance, a serious type of disease, and the manifestation can be in the lungs or in the intestines or in the brain, and then that is given a name in the normal medicine, understanding of normal medicine, and that name is what we call tuberculosis. So this is what we call tuberculosis on the physical plane, because when once it is made to investigation in the normal investigation methods, then in a test it is found if the person is having tuberculosis. So it may be mostly in the lungs or intestines, or sometimes in the brain or sometimes in the bone. So wherever it may be, but that can be traced back, because that is due to the inheritance of the miasm tuberculosis by the child, and which has been neglected because we don't know that it is a disease. So in the behavior, so first of all it is one example. Kleptomania is one example. There are many sorts of tubercular miasm. So there are many types of expressions. So some of these expressions will be there which we may not identify, because we don't know that it is a disease. So we may feel, sometimes there is also another thing is, if this intense degree of this miasm is inherited by the child from the father, for example, the father is highly tubercular in his behavior, and still in the father also it is not brought on the physical plane, before that this fellow is born, the child. So this is already inherited. So this father, when he happens to observe this in the child, he appreciates. This also we have seen many cases practically. Yeah. Because it was inherited from him. His child has inherited this directly on that plane, it has inherited, and this behavior is appreciated by the father. When others could identify this, oh, it's something abnormal, he is stealing and telling all false things and lies and all. But for the father, he appreciates. This we have seen also some cases. There was a teacher who was a colleague of master in the college, and he was speaking to his colleagues, teachers, and, you know, my son is very wise and intelligent. And they asked what he has done. He said, I had taken my son to a marriage along with me to attend a marriage function. And then, in those days, 1 rupee is has a big value, and it is now 1 rupee is nothing for us. So in those days, 1 rupee is a big value. As he said, you know what my son did? There was one coin of 1 rupee there, and first he has taken his handkerchief, you know, hanky, the cloth, and then just he took this, and then he put this on, and afterwards he has just picked up along with this and put. And after coming back home, he has shown me this coin. Papa, I brought this like this. See how intelligent he is. This is what he was telling. So he was appreciating the intelligence of the son. That is very fun of it. That means that fellow is, you see, you can imagine the intensity of the miasm in his behavior. Father's, exactly, it was inherited. So it will more and more increase. It is from the very childhood in this next generation. In his generation it was not, it has developed later, but in the next generation it has developed from the very beginning. So this is example of intensifying of the miasm.
and why do they say that pregnant women are kleptomaniacs? In my country, for instance, they say that a woman who is pregnant and she steals things from the shop, she's not punished. Because apparently kleptomania would be associated to the pregnant
lady. Because?
Yeah.
Because she received the infection of the miasm, mm-hmm, from the partner.
Mm-hmm.
Ah. That is the reason. Even though she was not having this miasm before, but due to this contact, she has inherited this, because that is one method of contacting.
But what happens in our country, very often the parents minimize it, say, our own children do that.
Yes. because they don't know that it is a disease, therefore they make a general understanding, all children nowadays do this, but that is not true. It is true that most of the children now have, they are affected by this miasm. That is true, but that is not true as a general statement that all the children are. No, not all the children. Children have different type of behavior depending upon the dominance of the miasm which was there inherited from the parents.
This is even worse than we think.
Because at the present times, the miasm is never understood even yet now. So in the present time, a child can inherit one miasm from mother, one miasm from father like this. It can, because it is a complex thing. So then, which miasm is dominating in the child, that will be expressed in the behavior. So therefore, it is a big task to identify this. But what Hahnemann has proved is, it is possible to identify. Because from the very clear, there are very clear indications. These are in the form of the distortions in the behavior. What is a distortion is abnormality in thinking and abnormality in behavior. For example, when a child is there, when the child is hungry, you have given some food. So even after taking food, still the child wants to eat and eat and eat. That is abnormality. That is it. There is certain limit. And then after certain time, when this is digested, then the child will be hungry. So when you find a child, not only child, even some adults also, you can find many people, some even in grown-up people also, some people constantly keep on eating and eating and eating all the time. So that is an abnormality. That is not natural. If some person is starving, if some persons are there on the other extreme. Some persons, even though they are hungry, they can starve and starve. That is another extreme. That is also a miasm. That is also an effect of the miasm.
Which one?
Sora. And then eating and eating and eating. So these are all bulimia. So bulimic, anorexic, bulimic, all what we call, these are all various manifestations of the miasmatic conditions. So there are anorexic, anorexic can be soric, basically sora, but it can be expressed also in syphilitic and the miasms.
What about the small child who is biting other children?
Yes, that is the effect of psychotic miasm. Yes, harming others, biting and doing all this. That type of behavior, a behavior to hurt others, that is a psychotic behavior. A behavior to hurt himself or herself, that is syphilitic. These are two opposite poles. One is suicidal, another is homicidal. This is two opposite. So therefore, you see how the miasm, when the miasm has affected the mind of the person, it interferes with every thought, every action of the person to distort. Because always miasm is such a negative force which drives the person into wrong action and wrong thinking and wrong action simultaneously. Wrong action, wrong thinking. And that is why the power of discrimination is distorted. Every person has this power of discrimination. So this discrimination, if a person is healthy in its true sense, so the discrimination is always used in every aspect. Constantly this discrimination is applied. Discrimination is like a light in our hand. So when we are walking when it is dark, we need a light in the hand to. So this discrimination is like a light, an inner light, which is there in every person.
That's not buddhic.
Buddhic. It is on the buddhic plane. This power of discrimination is an instrument placed on the buddhic plane. So this is, when miasm is there affecting a person, this does not allow the person to utilize this power of discrimination. So that is distorted. So then the thought and action are disturbed. That is how there is a distortion of thought and action. So when such a distortion is there, this will disturb the function of vital force constantly. So therefore, constantly there is an effort by the vital force to get normalized. Because with the vital force, as I told you, continuously it is abnormal in its function, then our life is in danger. Because vital force is our, as I told you, vital body is the most important factor for the existence and functioning of our physical body. The shape of the physical body, the functioning of the physical body, all this depends upon how the vital body is formed. So the vital body, is constituted by the lines of forces, as I told you, by the vital force. So therefore, the vital force has a mechanism which is arranged by nature, law of nature, that as quickly as possible it tries to get into normal functioning. But the miasm constantly keeps a pressure not to allow the vital force to function normally because of all these disturbances from the mental plane, from the mind. So constantly the vital force is kept under pressure, so it makes an effort, and in this effort, as I explained to you, this toxic effect is created and this is transferred. So this is the total phenomenon. So that is why Hahnemann, with all his insight and his research and all this, he could see all this what is happening in the human beings. Otherwise, why the human beings are affected of so many complex types of disease and suffering at every step? So these are the various factors. So unless you rectify at the level of mind, there is no solution. That is what he has shown. It is not just enough. It is necessary that you have to make your physical body clean and fit and all, but that is true. But unless you eliminate this from the mental level, all your effort, what you are making on the physical level, is only temporary. That is what Hahnemann has proved to us. No, when one is disturbed, automatically it disturbs others. Mm-hmm. The two poles, receiving and transmitting.
Yeah.
Okay. So both are disturbed.
Yeah.
Because it is out of balance.
Yeah.
they are interconnected.
Mm-hmm.
So one disturbs the other. It is just like how we have studied in Ayurvedic study. The three energy centers, Vata, Shleshma and Pitta, when one is disturbed, then it disturbs the others. So like that.
Now there is much more Vata, it's also because of the miasma.
That we have to be very, because that is, let us be clear in one aspect, then we will. Otherwise there will be confusion. So therefore, Sora, that is why Hahnemann has given so much explanation about Sora, how Sora can be identified, how it is to be dealt with, because we must know what is the procedure to deal with this, because what he has shown with many examples is, if you try to suppress the manifestations, then it becomes more stronger. The manifestations are suppressed when you make any effort without similarity. So we must be clear with all these things. If you use any substance which has no similarity in its effect with what is happening, because every time the vital force is producing symptoms. So you have the totality of symptoms from the activity of the vital force. So the substance which you want to administer for this should have a similar totality of symptoms, similarity. And without similarity, if you use any substance, you are producing an artificial disease which has no similarity. So if there is no similarity, one disease cannot eliminate other disease. So both the diseases can exist simultaneously, and they will strengthen the power of miasm in us. That is the problem. The miasm gets more intensified. So first of all, we have to, before we want to treat or we want to do something for real, to bring real cure, first we have to know that we should not make any effort to increase the power of miasm. That is the first thing. Because if the miasm gets stronger, then whatever we want to do, whatever effort becomes either temporary or useless. Because the miasm can make another manifestation. That is what we have seen. If you suppress one manifestation, it can make another new manifestation. Then we understand this as a new disease. It is not a new disease, it is a new expression of miasm. That is to be very clearly understood. Generally, what we are thinking is there are many new diseases coming into existence with new names and all these. But they are not new diseases, but only new expressions of these same miasms. So that is very deceiving to us. We are deceived by the new expressions. So when we consider them as a new disease, then we will try to invent new medicines for the new disease. New disease and new medicines. So it will be only a futile game. So therefore we have to properly understand how the miasm is, in which stage, in which intensity is there in a particular person. That is first what we have to do. If the person is having very dangerous acute condition, then first we have to do something for that. But afterwards we should not stop. So we have to make a proper decision. Is it absolutely necessary to do something on the physical tissue immediately? In certain cases it is. Or if there is no immediate danger for the person on the physical body, then you have to first find out how you have to work on the miasm to eliminate that effect. So this is not just enough by just if you receive a patient and then administer a dose. That is not enough. You have to make a constant observation and study of the patient again and again. You may not be able to ascertain which miasm is working in the person and in which degree. This is not immediately, you cannot do it. But you have to follow the procedure given by Hahnemann. You have to make the symptoms, observation of the symptoms, and observation of the patient, how the patient is expressing, and our observation, and all these things, all the information. So that is why it is a work of not at one meeting, but again and again. But we have to always remember that the patient always feels of about what is acute problem is there, only about that the patient is always mindful. Because every person does not know all this. So the person comes to us means with some acute problem, generally. Unless the person is educated before about all these things, no person will come to you telling that, please give me some treatment for, because I am having hatred and jealousy. Nobody will come back to you. Or I am having kleptomania, please treat me. Nobody will come to you. Because the person, we are not educated in this sense. So persons come to you as patients only for the problem which is acute. So therefore we have to make that such an effort. And for that we must know more and more about the miasm, how this miasm, in how many ways that it can express and influence the human organism. That is our study. That is the actual main part of our study, because we can study materia medica, we can study afterwards symptoms, gathering the symptoms and repertorization and all these. But repertorization is at a later stage, especially when learning homeopathy. If you start studying repertory immediately, then you will get lazy. Because you know more, you will make an effort to study about this miasm and all these things. Because now, for repertorization and everything, there are computer programs which are ready for you. You just put the rubrics and you get the medicine indicated before you and you administer the medicine. But to observe the miasm, to understand the miasm, this is not in any way useful. Repertorization is useful, but first you have to get acquainted in the study of the miasms and all, understand all this. So this is the procedure which we have to follow. That is why Hahnemann has given, at the later stage of his life, he has given all this and explained, first you must know about this, definitely about the miasms, and then only you can try to treat the persons. Because there should be, even with homeopathic medicine also, you can suppress. If you administer without similarity, only on pathological basis, even with homeopathic medicine also, you can make the same effect of suppression. So therefore, the study of miasms is very important. That is what is. So the swara, which is the basic miasm, this it takes some years for us, because it is a constant effort to study about it and observe how it is manifesting and how can we identify. This we have to make a constant effort to study. Because when we study many, many persons, then we can understand. Because you will not find all the manifestations in one person. That is not possible. Because there are hundreds of manifestations. So when you observe many people, then you can identify from their thinking, from their behavior. So this is where you have to make a study. So swara, but from the basic nature, the characteristic, when you know the characteristic features of a miasm, then you can know that how it is translated into action. That is what we see. From that we can identify. So the basic nature of swara, as we have seen, animals you cannot correlate like this, because in animals it is only instinctive. It is instinctive to take their food. But afterwards you don't find this behavior in everything in animals. Whereas if it is there in a human being, this will be translated into every action of the person. So that is the difference. So it is very difficult to completely understand the human constitution with all the complexes. That is why when you treat the animal with the homeopathic medicine, it is very very quickly,
yes,
it has,
yes,
much result, because the other complexity is not there in animals. In the human beings it is very complex, because of our effect, our actions. In animals they do not make something which is against nature, but we always behave against nature. So that is the big difference between human beings and the animals. Animals have, for example, animal, what is there common for humans and for the animals is food. Appetite and food is common. Food and drink, appetite and thirst, that is common. And
a horse, for instance, a horse which is, we say a horse can 90% you can be sure it's arsenic malbo, for instance, it's the nature of the animal, no?
The basic instinctive nature is different, but reaction, you must see about the in the reaction, behavior in reaction, that is different. In human being, the instincts and emotions, all these layers are there.
Mm-hmm.
From lower to higher, all these different layers are there.
Mm-hmm.
So when the human behavior, only when the human being is on the lower level, only instincts will be there.
Mm-hmm.
So these instincts are like the animal instincts.
So they are easier to cure?
If it is not suppressed, then it is. If there is abnormality there, then it can be. So we human beings, it is like that. But in the animals, what is common in the animals is only the needs of the sustenance. Those are common, but other things, human being is completely different, because we have the problem for human beings is we have more independence to decide for ourselves. That is the problem. Whereas for other beings in the creation, they will go according to the decision of the nature. But here we are independent, because we have eaten the forbidden fruit.
So can you then say that the evolution of man, if you go further, if you turn into, I don't know, a planet from some moon or whatever, is there an even bigger complication because the
No. That evolution into higher can be possible only when you cross this. That is what you
are. So human stage is the only stage that passes.
In human stage, through, because the consciousness has to pass through all the stages.
Okay.
That is the evolution of consciousness. That is very well explained in the books of Blavatsky and also Alice Bailey.
Mm-hmm.
In the evolution of consciousness, how this evolution goes on and from where. Because then you have to cross the human evolution also, higher human and then divine.
Mm-hmm.
So divine plane only when you get rid of this, otherwise you cannot enter into divine.
Mm-hmm. But it doesn't mean that there are more complications in the next level because there is more freedom. It's only on human level.
And there, when you cross the human, higher human and enter divine, there is freedom, but and there the freedom is given, but there is no misuse of freedom. Then only this is divine. When they have crossed misbehavior, then it is. There it is freedom, and there also freedom. There is no freedom in other beings. In a human there is freedom. In superhuman divine also there is freedom, but there voluntarily they keep the purity. Then only it is divine.
Mm-hmm.
But here, in a human stage, we can keep that, but we don't keep. You see,
okay.
this is what you also study in this biblical story, in story of Bible also. Fall of man means, what is the fall of man? in the story of Eve and Adam and fall of man, the fall of man because of the Satan. So because he has inflicted man to behave against the instruction of God, that is what you see in the story. And that is what Sora. In other words, it is Sora. So it is very clearly the same. Because it is only when the mind is miasmatic, then only it makes you to behave against the law of nature. So misbehave with nature because of Sora. That means that same thing is shown there as that negative force, which has induced Eve to eat the fruit. So that is in that story. They're the same. That is Sora. So when you go above human into the divine, then there is no misbehavior. Because there it is we behave voluntarily cooperating with the law of force.
Yeah, yeah.
Law of nature.
I understand.
So now it is time for lunch.